We always do this to make sure that our minds and our hearts are prepared before we meet the Lord. Let's pray in adoration now, acknowledging God as the creator of all things. Let's pray. Let us come before the Lord in the prayer of confession. Whatever it is, maybe even for the past year, we want to come before the Lord and trust that when we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, and He will forgive us for what our Lord has done for us on the cross. So let's pray in confession now. In the prayer of thanksgiving, we give thanks in all circumstances, especially for the past year. And let's spend some time being thankful to the Lord in our prayer. Let us pray. And now in the prayer of supplication, we tell the Lord what is in our heart, what are the needs of our life. Let's pray in supplication. Let us pray together. We thank you, God, for this first Sunday of the year, and we gather together in the name of Jesus to worship you. We do pray that you grant us a heart that is humble and teachable, that we are going to wait anxiously and with great expectation to you speaking to us through the prayers, through the songs, the reading of your word, and of course the hearing of your word as well. May all glory be unto your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning our brother Damawan will be leading us.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Happy New Year. So in a blink of an eye, 2022 is over, and now we are entering 2023. And for many, the past few years might have been filled with hardships and struggles. But I hope all of us can still reflect on the blessings that God has given throughout the year and rejoice in Him and give thanks continuously. So before we start, I would like to invite everyone to greet each other. Let us stand and let's wave to each other. And for those of you at home, I always encourage you to hug and kiss your family. Let us prepare our hearts for today's worship service by taking a silent meditation. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You return man to dust and say, "Return, O children of men." For 1,000 years in your sight are but as yesterday when it is past, or as a watch in the night. That is our call to worship, taken from Psalm 90, verse 1 to 4. Congregation, let us rise and let us praise the Lord with the first hymn, "Praise Ye the Lord, the Almighty." Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise ye the Lord, who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelters thee under His wing, ye so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desires there have been granted in what He ordaineth? Praise ye the Lord, who with marvelous wisdom hath made thee, decked thee with health and with loving hand, guided and stayed thee. Out of in grief, I thought He brought thee relief, spreading His wings for to shade thee. Praise ye the Lord, O let all that is in me adore Him. All that hath life and breath, all their praises before Him. Let the Amen sound from His people again. Gladly for hay we adore him. It is indeed very suitable for us to sing this song as we enter the new year, to praise God in glad adoration, for he is our creator, sustainer, and salvation. The second stanza elaborates that God who reigns above all things, God who is sovereign, is also the God who shelter us under his wings and sustains us gently. So that all that we ever need have been granted to us in what God has ordained. Oh, what a consolation, brothers and sisters, that our God, who is almighty and sovereign, cares so deeply for us and what we need. And not only that, he sustains us so that we remain within what he has ordained. May this year we continue to respond, resounding the Amen with praise and adoration to what God has ordained for us in our lives, so that his name will be glorified. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we know that for those who love you, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to your purpose. And as we come to worship you at the beginning of a new year, we pray that you renew our faith and help us, Lord, to remain faithful. Come with me. We pray for the Holy Spirit to illuminate us and give us understanding as we listen to your word. Bless your humble servant, Pastor Yong, in sharing the word of God, and work in our hearts and mold us in obedience, so our lives may be pleasing to you and bring you glory. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let us sing the second hymn day by day and prepare our hearts to observe the Holy Communion.
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is time beyond no measure gives unto each day what he deems best. Loving me, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust your promises, O Lord, that I lose all faith with consolation offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meet me, and to take as from a Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land. Till I reach the
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I hope you can hear me. We're going to have our Holy Communion, this being the first Sunday of the year. So we invite all brothers and sisters who have been baptized into the Church of Jesus Christ, wherever that church may be, to join us as we commemorate the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's listen to the Word of God. Came from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you promise, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We have Holy Communion in obedience to the red word of God. And this is one reason why you should not be always doing cyber worship service. It is a time for us to gather together to be with the people of God. And yesterday in Jakarta, Reverend Billy Cristanto was talking about Holy Communion and the significance. And he said that Holy Communion is a time where you gather with your enemies. When you are in church and you don't like this guy, you don't like that guy, but because of the communion, you're gathered together to remind yourself that you are people of God. And so it is for us all as well. I invite Brother Damawan and Brother Hadi to come and help me minister the element. But I will ask Brother Hadi to lead us in a prayer.
Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we come before you this morning with a contrite heart and also with thanksgiving for the new year. We ask that you look into our heart, cleanse us from sins, secret pride and things that are hindering our relationship with you. As we partake in this Holy Communion, help us to remember the price and penalty that you have paid on the cross for us, for the amazing grace. We give thanks, God. Please forgive our sins. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray.
Amen. So please take the elements, the cup and the bread, and hold on to it until all have received. Then we will partake of it together. Let us sing the song according to thy gracious word. Thank you.
Still have not received the bread or the cup, you raise your hand. With those who have received the bread and the cup, would you please stand? Anyone else we are missing? Oh, at the back, okay. Yeah. Hold on a while, let us. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the bread symbolizes the body of Jesus Christ and the cup, the blood that he has shed for us. Let us partake together with thanksgiving in our heart. I will invite Brother Damawan to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you, O Lord, that we may remember as we take this bread, as we drink the cup, we remember and with the eyes of faith, we see you here with us, O Lord, in this very room. And we thank you for all your work, O Lord, the salvation that you have given, that we may receive, O Lord. We pray that this becomes our strength and this continue to become a remembrance in our life, O Lord, that we live solely to serve you, O Lord, throughout our lives. In Jesus' most precious name, we surrender our lives again and again so that you may work in our lives, O Lord, for your glory. In Jesus' most precious name, we pray.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Let's sing the according to thy gracious word again as the brothers collect the cups back, or we just throw away. According to thy gracious word, in meek humility, this will I do, my dying Lord, I will remember thee. Thy body broken for my sake, my bread from heaven shall be. Thy testament, the cup I take, and thus remember thee. Gethsemane, can I forget, thy conflict see? Thy agony can bloody sweat and not remember thee. To the cross I turn my eyes and rest on Calvary. O Lamb of God, my sacrifice, I must remember thee. Remember thee
and all thy fears, and all thy love to me.
It's time for today's responsive reading. I invite the congregation to read the even-numbered verses. Let's open the first passage of responsive reading, taken from the book of Proverbs, chapter 1, verse 1 to 33. Proverbs chapter 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David. King of Israel. To receive instruction in wise dealing, in righteousness, justice, and equity. Let the wise hear and increase in learning, and the one who understands obtain guidance. I invite all of us to read together, verse 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. You can continue with verse 8. For they are a graceful garland for your head and pendants for your neck. If they say, come with us, let us lie in wait for blood. Let us ambush the innocent without reason. We shall find all precious goods. We shall fill our houses with plunder. My son, do not walk in the way with them. Hold back your foot from their paths. For in vain is a net spread in the sight of any bird. Such are the ways of everyone who is greedy for unjust gain. It takes away the life of its possessors. At the head of the noisy streets, she cries out. At the entrance of the city gates, she speaks. If you turn at my reproof, behold, I will pour out my spirit to you. I will make my words known to you. Because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof. When terror strikes you like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, therefore they shall eat the fruit of their way and have their fill of their own devices. But whoever listens to me will dwell secure and will be at ease without dread of disaster. Let us turn to the second passage taken from Lamentations chapter 5, verse 21 to 40. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21 to 40. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. They are new every morning, and great is your faithfulness. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. For the Lord will not cast off forever. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve the children of men. To deny a man justice in the presence of the Most High. Who has spoken and it came to pass unless the Lord has commanded it? Why should a living man complain, a man, about the punishment of his sins? Praise God for his word. Let us continue praising the Lord with the third hymn, Blessed Assurance. Some of you may know that this song is written by Fanny Crosby, someone who is blind, not from birth, but from very young, from his small. But as we are familiar with her songs, so we understand that she has eyes of faith that can surpass what she can really see in real life. So this is one of the great songs that Fanny Crosby wrote. It says, Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. What a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Okay. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. So let us sing this hymn with a reverent heart. It's okay.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Can I invite the sisters to sing the second stanza?
Echoes of mercy whispers
together.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
The brothers. perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. Together. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Next, we have a video anthem titled While the Ages Roll. As we enjoy this hymn, let's prepare our hearts for today's sermon.
Someday the stammering tongue will falter no more, and a grander, sweeter song I shall sing. For I'll join the ransom choir on heaven's bright shore, forever to praise the King. And while the ages roll, I'll keep on praising Him, and my voice will never tire or grow. And my song shall ever be, praise the Lamb who died for me, and I'll sing it while ages shall roll.
When a million years have passed in that wonderful place, my song of praise will just have begun. For my joy will never end while I look on His face, and my song will never be done. And while the ages roll, I'll keep on praising and my voice will never tire or grow old. And my song shall ever be, praise the Lamb who died for me, and I'll sing it while ages shall roll.
And while the ages roll, keep on praising Him, and my voice will never tire or grow old. And my song shall ever be, praise the Lamb who died for me, and I'll sing it while ages shall roll. And I'll sing it while ages shall roll.
What a wonderful song. Today's scripture reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 to 21. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard Him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to Himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled with God, to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of the Lord. I pass the pulpit to Pastor Yong.
Blessed New Year. Today is the unusual day in that New Year is on Sunday itself. Just like last week, right? Last week, Christmas, Christmas Sunday. So it's a little bit odd usually. And you know, there are some churches that do not have New Year Day worship service because same reason they don't have Christmas Day worship service because people, they expect people to party through the night. Eh? And so in the morning, cannot wake up to come to church. So they kind of stop it. So in the United States of America, especially, almost 40% of the churches will not hold Christmas Day worship service nor New Year Day worship service. Sometimes they do a watch night service instead. Now, so today we are going to be talking one special topic relating to the New Year. And it is appropriate also because it's all around us, right? So yesterday, together with many of our co-workers, I was in Jakarta for a few days for our synod meeting. And we were staying in a small little hotel that is within walking distance to the church. And the hotel was kind of sleepy until Saturday. All of a sudden, it came alive because a lot of people check in for whatever New Year celebration that they have. And we then have our meeting back in the main church and left. And for me, we tried to get back here. I tried to get back home before the New Year started, and I made it just as I stepped into my house to hear the neighbors countdown and a New Year kept coming and all that. And but I was just, I think, 1 second too late. It's like, so usually in my own tradition, every New Year Eve, I will be reflective of the New Year and do my own countdown, you know. But this year, I didn't get to do it. But you know, this is an occasion where the entire world is, of course, celebrating. And the biggest celebration in the world, or most famous one, is often the one associated with the Sixth Avenue in New York, where everybody will gather to watch a lighted ball dropped down from the Rockefeller building. Apparently, this tradition has been around for like long, long time, you know. And there's more than 1 million people will squeeze themselves into New York City just to watch this thing happen. And it is a security nightmare for them because every year they keep wondering whether some terrorists or whatever will target the place. And so it's always a scary thing. But in Singapore, of course, we always do the Marina Bay thing. Anybody been there yesterday? Anybody here went there? All those who went there are still sleeping at home now, right? Because it's one of those things that in Singapore we do. And it's like a big celebration there only. I actually once made a representation to the government to have this spread over all over the island instead of just one isolated place. And you don't have to like burn all your fireworks within like 5 minutes, right? You could space it out over time. The official answer from the government is cannot, because aeroplanes fly everywhere in Singapore. So it will affect the flight plan. So that's why it's a very calculated thing. But still, you know, it's a thing that attracted a lot of people. And because of the disaster in Korea, this year they blocked off some of the most prominent places, the Malayan Park and all that. It's typical Singapore kiasu thing. You know, just last time they never think about it, but there's a disaster in Korea, people die, and so this year they block off a lot of places. But wherever you are, also you have people having celebration in your own house, party and all that. I was half expecting this place to be empty, so I'm quite happy that you're all here, which means that you are not the party people, you know. A lot of party people out there. And this is a really global thing. Apart from Christmas, perhaps New Year will be the one festival that is celebrated globally. And there's a, today we want to think a little bit about why that is the case. The celebration of this newness, right, on January the 1st in every single year. But there are some things that may surprise you, actually. The celebration of New Year actually has not always been set on the 1st of January. Today, we take it for granted at the turn of the year. Everybody, millions of people around the world celebrate it. But that has not always been the case, you know. Actually, to set the 1st of January as the day you celebrate New Year is not that ancient a decision. It was something that was set in 1582 by Pope Gregory the 13th of the Roman Catholic Church, which at that time, of course, they were the center of the European world. And so he set what is called the Gregorian calendar, which is what we are using now. So the calendar we are using now, we call it the Western calendar. Actually, it's called the Gregorian calendar because there's a quite a complication relating to calendar design, like leap year and what have you, and you know, a lot of things relating to astronomy and everything coming together. And so in 1582, Pope Gregory the 13th declared the Gregorian calendar, and the 1st of January was declared as the start of the new year. So the celebration was officially set at that time. And even after this was set, it was not the case for many, many long years. The British and the Americans, for example, did not adopt 1st of January for more than 100 years after it was set. They kept celebrating the New Year Day on March the 25th instead. And of course, most of us here are Chinese people. You know that the Chinese don't even quite care, right, about this. To the Chinese, the main calendar is the Lunar New Year. So Chinese New Year is always deemed to be more significant. And other than the Chinese, the Hindus, they have their own New Year and different kind of celebration going on. Till today, there are some places in the world that sets another day very significantly, like Ethiopia. I have a friend who is from Ethiopia. She told me that, you know, in Ethiopia, 2 days are very important. One is Easter. So they celebrate Easter more than they celebrate Christmas, which I think make a lot more sense. They celebrate Easter, the resurrection of Lord Jesus Christ, a lot more important than the birth of Jesus Christ. And the second one is this festival called Antutasas, which is a new year for the Ethiopians. So to them, this is like more important than the 1st of January. So while we look at this kind of newness and the urge to want to celebrate, right, the fact really is that there is physically no significance to January the 1st as a day compared to many, many days in the physical world. Now, for example, if you celebrate birthday, there's something special about birthday because that's the day you are born, right? So it's a special day. But January the 1st, if you think in terms of the way the earth moves, any physical significance, the answer actually is no. If you look at the way the earth rotates around the sun and the significance, there are some points of significance in the physical existence of the earth going around the sun. And these are four of the more significant ones are the two solstices and two equinox. So a solstice is like winter solstice, the one on the left, is the one particular day of the year where the earth receives the least sunlight. So that's called winter solstice. In Chinese, it's called 冬至. And in 冬至, what do you eat? Tang yuan, my favorite dessert, yeah. Please don't go and buy a lot of tang yuan for me, huh? The last time I mentioned this, wow, there's a couple of people next week brought a lot of tang yuan and said, don't do that. So, 冬至 means the beginning of winter. And that one you can count is a physical thing, right? That very day is begin winter because that very day is marked to have the least sunlight. And opposite to that is the summer solstice, the other way around, the one day of the year where the earth receives the most sunlight. So that's a physical significance. You can declare that summer has occurred. But even for that, as you can see from the chart, the day is not fixed. So it could be June 20 to 22nd. Every year it moves a little bit differently, December 21st to 22nd. The other one is the equinox. The September 22nd to 23rd is the day where the sun is directly right smack at the top of the equator, dividing the world into two halves. And then March is the other time where it's on the other side of the equator as well. So these are significant
physical phenomena that you can mark. But January the 1st is not. You can see all the dates. January 1st and nothing near there. So therefore, it's very odd in the sense that we would all clamor over something that was basically arbitrarily set in by Pope Gregory the 13th. And so it is very intriguing to think about why do we have this need for newness and the clamoring and the desire to be fascinated by something that is new, whether it's the turning of the year or when babies come and all that. And we have a lot of babies coming together up these few weeks, and very happy to see some of the babies that I've only seen on Zoom for a while. And every time a baby comes, you know, we are all very excited because it's new. Every time a baby, we think that a baby represents a better future, and also the young people and the children as well. For even when I was in primary school, we had to have civic classes. You got Gong Hao Gong Ming. They try to teach you how to be a better citizen. A bit of a propaganda thing by the government at that time. I don't know whether there's still such lessons today. I remember they always talk about how the children is the future of the country. 儿童是国家的未来, or something like that. Then I keep thinking to myself as a child that if the children are the future of the country, then what happened to adults? Don't they have to do anything? You know, we always project forward, right? So this group of kids is going to be our future. But then we were the future last time, right? So what happened to us? You know? So we always try to project ourselves forward to newness. And of course, it's not just about this. It's also about things around us. Not just abstract stuff, but also physical stuff that we own. We all like, most of us, you can't count me into that rank. Most of us like new things, right? I mean, you want a new car, you want a new house, can I have a new wife? But you know, you want to buy new things, and the people who sell things know that. So they always tell you this is a brand new, this is better than the last one. Especially Apple, my former employer, they are really, really good at this kind of new things. Every time they push out a new product, their marketing is so good that they make you feel that your old product is a piece of junk. You should throw it away already. Like the iPhone 14 come out only, you look at your iPhone, let's say iPhone 12, is like, how come I got such a lousy product? Huh? You know, they really know how to do that. But then when iPhone 12 came out, when you first bought it, it was like the greatest and biggest thing at that time, you know. So we are lured into all this idea of newness. And so all over the world, we keep celebrating New Year over and over and over again. And there are actually theological significance to this. The need for newness actually demonstrates a few realities in human existence. First of all, that we know instinctively that what we have now is not what it originally meant to be. Instinctively, so it doesn't matter if you're Christian or Buddhist or Muslim, atheist, gay, lesbian, doesn't matter who you are. You instinctively know that something is missing somewhere. And what I have today in my life is not what it should be. It can be better, it should be better. And so we always strive to be better. I'm talking about normal people. Not if you are one of those people who really bo chap, and in Chinese it's tang ping, you just do whatever you want, just float around. That's not a normal situation. Normal situation, you want things to be better, you want something, some abstract idea about perfection or having a happy and perfect life. Or at the very least, we hope for it to happen. Maybe we can't achieve it, but we somehow think that it can be done. So year after year, we just squeeze together with millions of people and hope and try to grab some abstract idea. So like, can you imagine being squeezed in New York City in the middle of nowhere, million people on the street? First question I ask is, where's the toilet? You get stuck in the middle of nowhere, and then you party, you hope, you look for that ball to drop, and everybody, Happy New Year! And then after that, you know, you make some resolutions and you hope to achieve it, and then you always don't achieve it. And then, okay, next year, start all over again. So we keep doing it. It's a hope. There are great significance of this habit, you know. And one observer of this is the Christian writer C.S. Lewis. One of the most famous quotations of C.S. Lewis is this. If we find ourselves with a desire that nothing in the world can satisfy,
The most probable explanation is that we are made for another world. This is a very brilliant observation. Huh? That means if you find that, hey, how come I'm always not satisfied with this life? There's some issue somewhere that I can't figure it out. C.S. Lewis says that that's because you are not made for this world. That's because, or rather, the world is not what it's supposed to be. It's not supposed to be like this. That's why you feel very dissatisfied. And of course, the answer then is to look into what exactly is the truth. And in the same manner, when we look at the world and we are celebrating, we really also want to know, what is this thing that we are hunting for? And is this world a good world, a bad world, getting better, getting worse? I think that's important for us to know. As we celebrate the new year and look forward to the new future, is it a brighter future we are looking at? The answer actually is a mixed bag of things. If you look at the world moving forward, 2023, 2024, and moving forward, and look at our children, their future, would it be a better world or a worse world? The answer is it's going to be a mixed bag of situation. If you look at some of the data that is available right now, some data is quite encouraging, like this one, share of the population living in extreme poverty. Extreme poverty means seriously poor. And I already told all of you, right, if you are sitting here, you are not an extreme poverty person, okay? I know that for a lot of us, it's 钱 is 永远不够用 type. You know, you're always not enough money all the time. But I tell you, absolutely true, because of the work I do, right? I travel to places with extreme poverty. Sometimes it's really, really scary, you know? I remember visiting one place where there's this old lady staying inside, and it was in a very remote place in China. And I went there, and when I went to look at how she lived, because we were thinking about having a Habitat for Humanity branch there. And so I went to survey the place. My goodness, I went into the house, I came out and I wept, because how could people live like this? And that's extreme poverty, right? So if you look at the chart, on the vertical side is by percentage of population in extreme poverty. Horizontal is the year. So in the year 1820, maybe about 78% of the people in the world live in extreme poverty. As you see, the blue color thing, it keep dropping through the years. By the year 2018, is it? Yeah. The number has dropped to maybe about 18% of the population of the world live in extreme poverty, which means that poverty is being alleviated, being helped. The world is getting better in that sense. And life expectancy is the other way you see how the world is doing. So in the year 1770, if you look at the red color, that's the representing Europe. Here's a different continent. The colors of the chart is a different continent. Europe, maybe about 35% people live for about 35 years. And that's about it, you know. That's the life expectancy. Expected to live for 35 years. Moving all the way to 2019, you see the chart go all the way up. So now the expectancy of an average European is somewhere in the region of 80 over years. So from 35 years to 80 over years, that's a big improvement in lifespan. And Asia and all that, and even Africa, the last one is Africa. Africa data only available in mid-1990. So when it was available, it was 20 over years only. So you're African living in 1995, you probably will live only about 25 years or so. But now it's hitting 63, 64 years. Because there's a lot of advancement in technology, medicine, and all these things. And one other way that people represent the number of child death, infant mortality. In case you don't know, Singapore has one of the lowest, if not the lowest, infant mortality rate in the entire planet. That indicates that your healthcare system is very, very powerful. So in 1990 in the world, about more than 12 million children will die before the age of 5. And by the time you hit 2020, the number is about 5 million. So more than half. That means a lot of children are surviving beyond that. So these are all good figures that shows that the world is getting better. Literacy rate also. That means people who can read and write. In 1800, 85% of the world population cannot read or write. Then all the way to 2016, now is only about maybe 20%. So therefore, more than 60% of the people already learn how to read and write. So these are all very good figures showing that the world, from a certain angle, is improving and life is getting better.
technology has advanced and created a lot of good things for people. So one of the key breakthrough is the use of the mobile phone. I was in the middle of Battambang in Cambodia, paddy field everywhere, and we were installing solar panels for all the very poor farmers. And I was there to see the investment, see what happened to the solar panels. I was very surprised to see that they used the solar panel to charge their handphone. So the solar panel come down to some USB thing, and then guy is charging his handphone. And then all of a sudden, I realized that, hey, this farmer guy and his children has access to the internet in the middle of nowhere. And it's very important, you know, because that means that they have ability to reach out to the world and learn new things, especially for the kids. And for them, it's a window that's open to the outside world. When I was growing up, I read that in India, without the mobile phone time frame, when you apply for a landline, you know what is a landline? You know? A land telephone. How many of you still have telephones at home? Yeah, those are old-fashioned people. Yeah. But now very few people have landline anymore because of mobile phone, right? In India, you apply for a landline, it'll take you 10 years. You've got to wait 10 years for that phone to come into your house, you know. But now with the mobile phone, immediately people can connect outside. So you can imagine that life, therefore, will get better. But of course, it also brings about other issues. So some of the other issues that are not very cool is like, although the extreme poverty rate has come down, the number of people making less than $2.15 a day, US dollar, a day, one whole day you work, you only make maybe about $4 or $5 Sing dollar. It's still very high. It's about, from the year 1990, there are 2 billion people like that red color proportion. And finally, to 2019, it's still about slightly less than 1 billion people, maybe 800 million people making that kind of money. That's quite terrible. And of course, we all know that while there are a lot of advancement everywhere, there are also a lot of frightening, horrible things that's happening. And some of the biggest thing that's threatening us in the world today is the concept of human extinction. Now, Christians have a different idea, right? Because we know our Lord Jesus Christ will come again. But scientists around the world are all observing things like climate change and, you know, all kinds of things that can possibly create human extinction. And one of the things that is very, very real and always being reminded would be the use of nuclear weapons. No thanks to the Kim, what's his name, up in the north, right? Every day he can fire rockets here and there, try to threaten his southern Korean counterparts. So much so that the BTS guy must go and serve NS now. So like, it's a terrible world. There are estimated 15,000 nuclear weapons in the entire world. And scientists calculated that if we want to eliminate every single human being, including you and I, all you need is 13,500 nuclear weapons. Fire all that at the same time, and the world human being will all be extinct. And you still have 1,500 left over as spare. So other than this, of course, there are so much turmoil and difficulties hanging around in the world that is quite scary. You look at the United States, America now, there's so much hatred between the different groups of people, the races, gender equality, the haves and the have-not, all kinds. And within Singapore too, there are a lot of issues that are pretty scary. One of the things that's so scary that caught the attention of the president herself is the great sudden surge of sexual scenes that are happening in Singapore, right? So she's recommending that people like me should be caned if I get caught, you know, doing nonsense thing. Because in Singapore, we don't cane people more than 50 years old. But she said that, oh, the situation is so severe that we should cane anyone so long as they are fit, kind of a thing. So all of a sudden, there's a lot of argument about this. So yeah, the society is in a turmoil in many ways. So if you look at the world, so can you then be very comfortable that, yeah, it's going to get better because the technology will, you know, bring advancement to many things? If you look at the COVID, for example, although we have gone through 2 years of, about 2.5 years of a pretty tough situation, right? I don't know whether you realize this or not. It was also a period of time where advancement moved really fast. That's a lot of people don't understand this. So when I was in CNOT meeting, I made a passionate speech about this because they were talking about how we want to go and forcefully force everybody to stop live broadcast. They are talking about that kind of thing. And I stood up and spoke passionately. I said, look here, you know, we are now in an era that you can't go back anymore. And if anything good come up from the COVID, is the idea that within a very short time, we managed to make something that used to cost a lot of money into something that's very common, this Zoom thing and this live broadcast. You know, before the COVID, you want to do this kind of live thing, it costs you a bomb, okay? But now every one of you can broadcast from your home. So that tool is actually a very advanced tool. The other one is the vaccine. I know that some of you are still vaccine skeptics, right? But the world is what it is today because within a very short period of time, vaccine technology leapfrogged like nobody's business. So much so that we are all here and a lot of you are not wearing masks. And so it's something that really, really is changing the world today. However, it is also very clear that we cannot measure well-being just by the physical alone, because it's not just about external well-being. If it is all about external well-being, then you shouldn't have any rich people committing suicide or having horrible marriages or having a miserable life or being depressed, right? Because I've achieved all these things. I have better health care. I have longer lifespan. My children grew up healthier. I got the latest gadgets. Then I should be quite happy. The answer, of course, is not so. And the Bible is very clear about this. Many Bible verses about this. The one that stick to me is the words of our Lord Jesus Christ himself. When challenged about this, it happened when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. And quite interestingly, the kids in the Sunday school, they were watching a cartoon that was talking about this. So the devil come to Jesus and say, hey, you know, you fast 40 day and night. Very impressive. That's not in the Bible, but in the cartoon, the devil say, very impressive. You can change the stone into bread. And Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Now, this statement is not just about food, you know. It's a statement about how, it's not just about things. It's not just about having a nice house or a nice car or better life or living better or longer. It's not, because you don't live by bread alone. There are so many other things that you need to think about. And that's precisely where the world has gone wrong, isn't it? And so year after year, we repeat the cycle. We keep looking for newness without really understanding what that newness is, because as C.S. Lewis said, we were not made for this world. So unless you find that answer as to what exactly am I supposed to be here doing? What is my life all about? What exactly did Jesus mean when he said it's not just about bread alone? What it does he mean by every word of God? If you don't figure that out, then like the rest of the world, you keep repeating the cycle over and over again. But if you figure that out, then all this kind of ritualistic newness would not mean too much to you. I'm not saying you shouldn't celebrate New Year, but I will tell you that for me, it's not a very big deal thing to me, because like I was explaining to you, right? No physical significance. And also, you know, there's a warm and fuzzy feeling thing out there. So we get the answer of what the missing piece of the puzzle is from the Bible, of course. And again, there are many Bible verses, and I pick for you today 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians, and he talked about how, you know, he and his co-workers have to work very hard. They have to face a lot of opposition, so much so that people thought that they are crazy people, do all kind of weird stuff. And that's how I do feel sometimes, that people look at me and say, hey, how can you do all these strange things? Verse 16, the Apostle Paul says, from now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. So Paul said that, you know, you must remember last time Paul, he was a guy who persecuted the church, right? He went after the Christians and all that. And here he said that, hey, you know, at one time I look at Jesus and I look at him according to the flesh. That means I look at Jesus, I look at this whole gospel thing, just like how the rest of the world look at all things, according to the flesh. But now I do not anymore. And one of the key indicators is because he used the word Christ. He did not use the word Jesus. Now, for those of you who have been in church for a while, I hope you know that there's a difference, you know. The word Jesus is actually a very common name. Even in the time of when Jesus Christ walked the earth. And till today, it's quite common, you know. If you go to South America, you know, a lot of people have the name Jesus, Jesus. Please don't name your child Jesus. That's not what you want to do in our part of the world. But it was a common name. So the key question is Jesus just Jesus to you? Or is he the Christ? Because the word Christ is very different. The word Christ means he's the anointed one, the one who has been sent, the one who has the solution, the Savior, the Messiah. That's what the word Christ means. So, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, is he Christ to you or is he just Jesus? If Jesus Christ is just a Jesus to you, you are looking at him in the flesh. But Paul says, we don't do that anymore because now I know he is Christ. Do you treat your faith in the same manner as you do with any other activities you have in life? That means when you come here for church and you think about churchy things and spiritual things, like, okay, this is like the one part of my life. And after this, I want to go and ask myself, you know, what's the next program I want to have? In a sense, there's nothing wrong because that's the way we live life anyway. But if you really look at our faith only in that manner, is it useful to me? Is it something that pleases me? Is it something that I feel happy about? Then you are looking at Christ according to the flesh, because that's the way the whole world look at it. And you will never figure it out unless you understand him as Christ and not as Jesus. We have been receiving different text, feedback, email things from different people. And there are people who write in to us and say things like, you know, I don't like to come to your church because you don't have this, you don't have that. One of the things that people talk about is Sunday school. Oh, you know, your church is so small. So my kids don't have Sunday school, proper Sunday school to go to. So therefore, goodbye to you. We are going to go somewhere with big Sunday schools and all that. This is a very utilitarian way of thinking, right? And I guess that's something that is very true and very real. When I was in my previous church, it's at Upper East Coast Road. The church is a very nice place. It's some guy left behind a mansion, you know. It was a mansion with big land. And he built it specifically for church use. And my church early leaders bought it first. But it was an old mansion. And so electricity kept tripping. So sometimes I preach halfway, all of a sudden blackout. Things like that happen. And so they always say that, okay, we're going to build a new church and all that. And I was a lead elder there. And I always resisted that because I always felt that I'm not very impressed with buildings per se. You know, I just felt that it's all about people. That's very important. And the budget to me was like astronomical, $5 million. Wow, so much money. I can do a lot with $5 million. That's nothing. Okay, today you better prepare 50 million first, not rupiah, sing dollars. So 5 million is very cheap actually. So okay, fine. Reluctantly, the whole board of elders decided to build and make me the chairman of the rebuilding committee or that. So okay, fine, we build. And so now the one that you see now in Upper East Coast Road, some of you want to use it for your wedding, right? It's the spanky new building. Yeah, very nice. You know what I did not expect? I did not expect that the attendance will increase after the church building came out. I did not really. Because I thought, okay, we want to do a church building because always blackout, so not very nice. We should have a building. But when the church building was up, the attendance moved up. People came because of a nice chair, nice aircon, nice parking space. Wow, toilet very nice. I mean, you know, maybe they came because of Hainanese chicken rice. Because it's Singapore's only Hainanese church. My mother is one of the kitchen queen of the. So the after church service, you can smell the chicken rice when you're having church service, and the chili. You know, people go and tap out the chili, bring back home. You have to stop them. So maybe who knows? My point is that people look for the physical and the exterior and all these other things. And they are actually looking at the faith with the flesh. But Paul says, no, we now regard Christ, he's Christ, we recognize him as Christ, it's more than all these things. I'm not saying it's not important for us to look at all these other things, and indeed we are. Just to let you know, in the coming year, we are trying to figure out, you know, can we go and rent another unit somewhere to do our Sunday school so that the kids can have a proper system. So please pray with us on this and come in and join in to be part of the solution. Don't keep pointing out the problems alone. That one we all can tell. So be part of the solution and join us. So those are important things to think about. But fundamentally, it cannot be just about the flesh. And after this, the Apostle Paul gave the most, perhaps one of the most famous verses in 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. This particular verse is probably one of the most famous verses in the Bible and in 2 Corinthians for sure. And you should memorize this as well. And every time I think about this verse, I think about picture to come with it, I always think about the butterfly. They love colorful things. And the butterfly is especially fascinating because of the metamorphosis. You know, you go to an airport, right? Our airport is perhaps the only airport in the world with a butterfly park. Leh. No need to pay some more. So nice. And the last time I traveled, I went to a butterfly park and stayed there for a long time because it just fascinated me, you know, to no end. Except what happened was that the foreign worker guy who was watering the plant watered me as well. He sprayed the water and sorry. So he was so afraid that I would complain. I said, no, it's okay. Butterfly coming out from the pupae is just marvelous, right? Because prior to that, the guy is a piece of funny looking caterpillar and all that. And you know, just this transformation is just really, really fascinating. And indeed, it's a new creation compared to the before. But I will tell you that there's many things about this verse that we missed out. Therefore, if anyone in his Christ is the new creation, the old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. The first thing you want to know is that Paul used the word therefore. The word therefore, there's something before, right? Those of you who do math, at the end of the day, you should therefore three dot, right? Dong, dong, dong. Therefore, this happened. Because of da-da-da-da-da, dong, 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 three dot, therefore, this happened. Therefore, what is this therefore? Because of the fact that Jesus is not just Jesus, the man, Jesus, the religious leader, Jesus, the nice guy. And I was telling David just now in the room, the cartoon, Jesus looked like Keanu Reeves. Jesus, the Keanu Reeves guy. It's not just about that. It's because Jesus is the Christ, the Savior, the anointed one, the guy who basically brought about earth-shaking change in all of human destiny. Therefore, because of the eternal plan of God to have our Lord be the Savior, the Apostle Paul then articulated the newness of it all. And in this newness, the next word is anyone. That is a marvelous word. Anyone. Therefore, if anyone. And the Chinese translation is not so cool. Chinese translation is 若有人. 有人 means someone, you know. It can be 路人甲, 若有人, if there is someone who is in Christ. This is not the original translation much better. Anyone. Anyone means anyone. Whether you are rich, you are poor, you are good looking, you are handsome, or very ugly, or you healthy, or weak, you very powerful, or you CEO, or you are the lowest ranking guy in your company, anyone. It's just the most amazing revelation. You know, at the synod meeting, one thing that disturbs me is that in Jakarta, in our church, the Hamba Tuhans are very well respected. Not like here, no, actually. Here, sometimes people, hey, Teck Meng. So, it's Reverend Yong Teck Meng to you, okay, hello. Over there is different, you know, the our Indonesian brothers and sisters, wow, they look at you, they, wow, Hamba Tuhan walk by, it's like you got some aura of holiness following you, you know. And one of the things I appreciate, but I don't quite like, is lunch. Because we had like 500 over participants in that synod meeting. So they prepare box lunch, right? So yeah, like, okay, we're going to queue up and get box lunch. Then somebody will tap you on the shoulder and say, go to that room, this is a room for you. Okay, well, you go to the room, then it's, wow, all the Hamba Tuhans are inside, all the pastors and different preachers are inside. and the box lunch is there, but there are also other sisters who prepare other things, you know, like what pork trotter la, oxtail stew la, I don't know what, Indonesian chendol, which I took a long time to ask whether I would risk food poisoning if I eat it, you know, but you know, I took it anyway. It's like, wow, special treatment. And then they got coffee machine in there, you know. And I felt very uncomfortable, you know, the rest of the people all queuing outside, and then I'm here, I'm enjoying this, right? It got me thinking, you know, whether to you, this all these things is only for all these holy men and women who serve God, and you know, then for me, I'm just a nobody, and you know, just queue up and all that. And yet, 2 days ago, Pope Benedict the 16th passed on, right? He's 95 years old, and you can tell that the whole Roman Catholic Church will have a very strange New Year because they have to figure out all this funeral and everything for him. And of course, in the Roman Catholic tradition, that's even more serious. Before long, he may be canonized as a saint. So do you think of your faith this way, that it's really about these pastors and all these people? They're the holy men, right? Sometimes people use the word professional Christian because we pay them to be holy. So, so pastor, can you come and pray for me? When I was an elder, I realized that, hey, there's a difference, you know. When you are deacon, nobody quite like to ask you to pray. Elder, more. But when you become a reverend, even more. Wow, people just want you to come and pray. And so we have that kind of concept. And it kind of doesn't help that I wear all these things, right? All these, wow, you know, the guy holier than us. I want to tell you, without all doubt, that the Bible is talking about you, okay? You're going to shift your holy responsibility to someone else. The Apostle Paul says, if anyone, so when you look into the mirror, he's speaking to you. You are the one, whoever you may be, whatever background, whatever it is that you have done in the past or in the future to come. God is speaking to you. Yes, there are some people among us who serve God more faithfully, I suppose, in some ways, and they are to be respected, as the Bible says. But don't ever think that faith is other people's business. That, you know, if I need something, I just call the Sai Kong to come and pray for me. It's not how it works. If anyone is in Christ, regardless of who you are, the Lord is speaking to you this morning. And it is have to be in Christ, because it's all about Jesus Christ. And Paul says that if that is the case, then you are a new creation. And you know, he wants to emphasize this again. He said, behold, the new has come. It is as good as starting all over. I think that this is the one part that a lot of people find difficulty in getting. Because how can it be so good and so great, you know? The Cantonese said, mo kam tai zai ge kam. I don't know why they have this kind of saying. It's like there is no such thing as a big toad that is jumping all over the street. Since I was young, I was wondering what kind of idiom is that? Who wants a toad? Who cares? So the Cantonese said there's no such, in English, there's no free lunch. So don't go and think that there's the big toad that jumps all over the place for you to catch. I don't know, maybe they eat toads. Cantonese eat anything anyway. So we keep thinking that there cannot be free lunch, what? You know? So you tell me that Jesus in Christ is a new creation. Seems like too good to be true, right? Isn't it? It's like, you know, it's free, really. You know, but I've done this in my life. I'm this, I'm that. I'm not a good person. I did a lot of harm. And that's one of the things that the devil always uses. I whisper in all your ears that, look here, you're a scumbag, okay? You don't deserve God, okay? Answer is, of course, we don't deserve God. None of us, including me, deserve any of the grace that we have received. The word grace means undeserved merit. You don't deserve it, you know. What's the answer? The answer is the word in Christ. It is in Christ, got nothing to do with you, okay? It got to do with Jesus Christ. And because of that, we are a new creation. For some of us who live a generally normal life and all that, sometimes it's a bit harder to appreciate this. And also the devil used that, right, to whisper in our ears and say, hey, your life very normal. Eh? You can never do anything wrong. One. So it doesn't apply to you. In our synod meeting, our missionary to Japan was sharing. Somebody asked a question, why the Japanese Christian number is so low? Guys, our missionary said that's because the Japanese achieve a lot. Ethically, they have achieved a lot without religion. So they think they don't need God. Right? I mean, the Japanese are very super clean, okay? Their public toilet can be cleaner than your house toilet, right? Because they really have this very strong discipline. And in the work I do in Habitat for Humanity, we notice that the Japanese, even the Japanese homeless, when they got no place to go, they wait until the MRT station is going to close, they will come in. And the MRT people will let them come in because it's warmer, especially winter, you can die out there. Then they will pick a spot, they will sleep for the night. Morning when they go, they pack, no? Pack already, sweep the place, so sweet, sweet, and then they leave, no? They are homeless people. So they are at that level. But of course, man does not live by bread alone. And so they miss that. They fall into the devil's trap of thinking that they don't need God. Admittedly, those who have gone through rough and tumble in life admittedly will appreciate God more. And in the ministry that I get involved in, which you can get involved in, Brother Hardy was involved in prison ministry, you have breakthrough mission, all this ministry relating to drug addict people. Right? You will see this verse come alive in their life. Because some of them are really gone through horrible things in life. When you're a drug addict, you do a kind of nonsense, you know. You rob your mother, man, in order to get the drug fixed. The pastor involved in Breakthrough Mission is Pastor Simon Neo, good friend of mine. He gave a testimony. He said the mother told him when he was a drug addict, look, wherever you stand, even the grass will die because you're such a horrible human being. And today he's a pastor. So how does it work? And Apostle Paul, who wrote this especially, he was a murderer. He went around yanking Christians and persecuting them, killing them. I mean, Bible didn't say he physically killed them, but he threw them into jail. So I can imagine some of them would have been tortured to death. And if this verse is not true, won't he go crazy being an apostle? Keep thinking that, wow, my goodness, you know, I'm not a violent person, I think. But I can imagine that when he was catching Christian, people would be screaming, right? Shouting, Mike, don't do this. The wife will be screaming, the kids will be screaming. You know, kind of scenery. If the Apostle Paul did not believe in this, if this is not the truth, I think he would have gone crazy. Because who knows how many people you sent to jail. But I tell you this morning with my hand on the Bible that this is true. And Paul repeated it, behold, all things have become new. So whatever it is that you have done in your life, whatever it is that you have encountered, whatever, the Bible says that if you are in Christ, and that's the key, you must be in Christ, you are a new creation. And the old has passed away. But I will tell you that it's not so simple, you know. This is a phrase I keep repeating, not so simple, because it's much more than that. Not only is it new, it is also a ever-renewing thing, which is so marvelous and so wonderful. The Bible is consistent in this. In your second responsive reading, I call you to read Lamentation chapter 3 by the prophet Jeremiah. This is the key verse there. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are what? New every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Jeremiah was lamenting about how everything is going down the toilet around him. And then in verse 21, he said, but I remember one thing. Then in verse 22, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. And it's an ever-renewing mercy to us. Or it don't get stale, it don't get boring, it get refreshed all the time. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. That is the kind of spirituality we are talking about. Because God is not a stale God. God is an ever-renewing, dynamic presence. And so when we are associated with Him, the renewer is ever constant. And in the earlier chapter in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul himself wrote, this transcends even the physical. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. Paul said that sure, all of us will grow old, right? We have wrinkles here and there and all that. Anybody who think that you won't grow old, you're fooling yourself. One of the things that Dr. Tong used to say is, every time you meet someone, you say, oh, 你真的长得还跟以前一样, 好像还很年轻, you know, like last time you still look very young. Dr. Tong's answer is, 那我岂不是变成妖怪? Does that mean I'm a monster because of vampire, you know, never grow old? That's not possible. We will all grow old and you will waste away. However, the inner self will be renewed day by day because the inner self is eternal and the outer shell is temporal. And our spirit gets renewed day by day. And I understood this from a very young age. So I'm one of those people who never say old, never say die, because it's a renewer. I mean, why do you all want to look old and think old and walk old? I don't get it, you know. And it's very Chinese, right? Sometimes when Chinese, some of you, including my late father, I observed that by the time he reached 50, he kept saying that, wow, 老了,没有用了,这边痛了,那边痛了,看不见了,这个要死了。 By the time you are 60 years old, you practice 10 years already, you know, saying those things. You will have psycho yourself to think that you really 老了,没事了,爱死了,没懂了, all that. One of my personal heroes is our brother Lim Yi Huat, who attends STEMI and Dr. Tong's meeting. He's on Chinese side, so you may not be familiar with him. Lim Yi Huat, ultra marathon runner. He would represent charities every year and raise funds. He raised 300,000 for my charity, running the Brazilian Death Valley, 127 kilometers in 2 weeks. Lim Yi Huat is 68 years old. 68, okay, 127 kilometers in 2 weeks. Ask you to do 1.2, so long, I don't do an ICL, you know. 120, okay, he is different. This kind of people, every time I see it, I say, 你根本都不是人, you know, not human, the kind of people. However, this is true, and I think that the best example among us would be our senior pastor himself. I mean, you can disagree with him on some things or whatever it is, but the tenacity and the determination that this man displayed is just beyond understanding, okay? And the newness in the spirit that he displayed. 讲得不好听一点, he acts as if he will live forever, you know? All his new ideas, new things, new that, even the synod meeting. His son David Tong was talking about a new new university that we are building. Just in case you don't know, we are building universities. We are also building 27 new churches all over Indonesia, all of which are like, wow, massive, giant building. And when I was there, I was so paiseh. He said, what do you want, Surabaya? No? That one is, don't know, Makassar. No? What about you, Singapore? I said, yeah, very hard to buy a land and all that kind of thing. Everything also said cannot. I wanted to say, you come and try lah, you say, make so much noise. This is not Indonesia, you know. And so David was saying that, oh, you know, we're building our university. Then he gave an update. He said that we think that we want to see whether we want to prepare in the future for a medical school. Now, when he said that, my ears perk up, because I know that all universities in the world, for you to be considered top rate, you should have a medical school. But it's a almost impossible thing to think about, you know. To a medical school is a different ballgame altogether. And so Dr. Tong, his father, was listening. Then later, when we went to the next segment, he took the mic and said, I now have a decoration. We will buy the 1.8 hectare land right opposite the university so that we can build a medical school in the future. I was like, wow. It's just the kind of drive, the kind of spirit is renewed day by day. And one of the fascinating things that happened in this particular meeting was the announcement of our church foray into healthcare. They declared the opening of Clinic Samaritan, which is a medical clinic that our church has set up to serve poorer people. I don't know where this place is, but it's quite an amazing story. One of the old churches moved to build another big church building. So the old church building was converted to a clinic. So this is our first healthcare thing with like five dentists and I don't know how many doctors in a place It's just like our polyclinic. It's just an amazing story to witness that our church is now also in this. So this medical school talk is not something that is not real, you know. In case you don't know, we are definitely a mega church, okay? So this clinic has all this A and E and everything. So a very interesting thing. And more fascinating is that they actually move into the rural areas to give free and subsidized healthcare to the people there. So my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this is not empty talk, okay? At the very least, from our senior pastor, you see that demonstration of how the outer self may be wasting away, but the inner self is being renewed day by day. For the Spirit of God is new, and His mercies upon us is fresh every single morning. And Paul then zoomed in as to the real reason in verse 18. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to Himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. And then he explained further. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to Himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Paul said that the newness, the ever-renewing presence, is from God, and that came about because of Jesus Christ. And what did Jesus do? First thing, reconcile us with God. Verse 20, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making His appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. I have shown you the next slide many times already, and I want to show it to you again. The two key reconciliation. It must start, as the Apostle Paul says, with a personal reconciliation with God. The vertical relationship with God must be made right. And I think this is the one thing that a lot of people, including Christians, keep missing. A lot of times we look at the issues in our life, and we try to find solutions that are, as Paul used, in the flesh. I'm going to solve this problem. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to use this method. I'm going to do this. This is not to say that methods are not important. They are. Life skills, the way you speak to each other, all these are important. But I will tell you that much of the fundamental issue has to do with whether you are reconciled with God already. And as I mentioned to you before, right, Eleanor Roosevelt said, no one can humiliate you without your permission. Behind this saying is this idea about the self, being at peace. When you are at peace with God and you are reconciled with God truly, the more you're reconciled with God, the less the things of the world will disturb you. If you are at peace with yourself, you are okay, you don't have to get angry so easily. You don't have to jump at everything that your spouse say or your colleague say or your boss say or whatever it is. You won't feel a need to look beyond your own marriage into another place. You are at peace with yourself. And this comes from reconciliation with God. And so long as you're not reconciled with God personally and continue to be reconciled with God day by day, you will always be lost. Only when you are truly reconciled with God can you go to the next step where you have reconciliation with the people all around you. When the self is at peace, then there can be peace with the rest of the world. And through Christmas, we even mentioned that, right? Glory to God in the highest. What's the next statement? And peace on earth upon those whom He is well pleased. And when that's the case, the Apostle Paul, in his verse, mentioned the true purpose of it all. We are the ambassadors for Christ and making His appeal to us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, He made Him to be sin who knew no sin. For our sake, God sends us Jesus Christ, who had no sin, but He knew sin because of us. And all these are done for what purpose? Remember the therefore? Therefore, for what purpose? So that in Him, we might become the righteousness of God. This is the reason why we live. We live because after we are reconciled with God, we become the righteousness of God. We become the channel of God. We become the ambassadors of Christ. We become the channel to which other people will see Christ. So our brother Damawan in his prayer just now got it right. That we are people who live for the glory of God, and that's our purpose. The Westminster Confession of Faith says the chief goal of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. If you ask yourself, what is the purpose of my life? The answer is God wants you to be His ambassadors, to reach out to other people, to be the righteousness of God. But to do that, you yourself first has to be reconciled with God. May we understand this fully as we approach a new year or every single day of our life, so that we are people who are not renewed just once a year. And then after that, next year, you start all over again and wonder what it's all about. And then you crowd into the street and yell, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Happy New Year. Blah, blah, blah. And then after that, you're miserable again. That's not how it works. Let us be renewed in Christ for all eternity. For His mercies to us is renewed every single day, fresh every morning. And what is in us should be renewed day by day. May the Lord bless us that so that we will see this. And may we be determined to be fully reconciled with Him. And we have to do that on a daily basis because we are fallen people, so that the freshness and the life of God will be in us. And when others look at us, they will give glory to the Father in heaven. Let us pray. We thank You, God, for the word that we have received this morning. And as we start this fresh year, we do want to continue to ask that You keep us close to You. For after the worship service, we step out of this place, immediately we will be with a whole gang of people in the world who all are talking about different things, pulling us into all sorts of direction, asking us to look at Christ in the flesh. May we hug close to You. May Your word continue to be the lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway, so that we will have a renewal of our spirit, not just once a year, but every single moment of our life, as the word has declared, so that we will live a life that is dynamic and abundant and free. Granted that there will be a lot of ups and downs in life, and sometimes You will allow those things to come to mold us, to train us, to teach us, because we're such stubborn and stiff-necked people. Keep us close to You nonetheless. Grant us the wisdom and strength we need to do that. May every single passing day bring us closer and closer to You, so that we can enjoy You forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with me, congregation, as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed? We do this every week to remind ourselves as the main tenets of our faith. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's spend some time praying. I want to just have one prayer item this morning. This being a New Year day, we want to commit the rest of the year, if not the rest of your life, to the Lord. So I want to invite you to pray for yourself and your loved ones this morning, committing the time to God and giving Him thanks for the many guidance He has given to us for the past year. And let's pray wherever you are. You can pray verbally or you can pray in your heart, and I will lead you in closing prayer. Let us pray. Father, we come before You and we do ask that You have special mercy on us all. May Your people continue to listen to Your word so that we will continue to walk together in this pathway of faith. Thank You, Lord, for being with us and teaching us. We thank You that You will be with us and You will continue to guide Your people in everything that they do. We know that You are God who will be above all and teach us to seek You, have a heart that is for You. They're always looking forward to doing the things for Your name's sake, for we are weak people. But we know You are strong. We know You are God who loves us and wants to be with us. Thank You, Lord,
and help us to rethink about the issues that are ahead of us so that we can rethink and recalibrate. And we commit the church into Almighty hands so that we take a chance to relook at some of the work that we do so that we won't do things that would disgrace your name's sake. Listen to our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray together. We thank you, O God, for this time and the lessons that we have learned, not just today, of course, but through the years as well. You are indeed gracious to us all. May we always turn our eyes upon Jesus so that we do not just look into the world and look into everything in the flesh, but we should look at everything through the eyes of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we commit our congregation once again to you in this coming new year, that we will always strive to be more Christ-like in everything that we do. The ministry that you have entrusted, not just to the pastor, but to every single one of us, is right here. And so grant us the wisdom and the grace to be part of the community of faith here, that we should never walk the journey of faith alone, but we should walk together with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ so that we can encourage one another, to support one another, and certainly to love one another. Oh, there are so many, many things that we ought to do that we have not, and many, many things that we ought not to have done, but we have. Whatever the case may be, we do know that it is in Christ that we are delivered. Help us to understand that and understand it deeply. Listen to our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. We now will have our offering. And those of you who want to give cash offering can put the cash offering in the box, the offering box right beside the door as you leave. If not, you can use the bank transfer data here. Maybe we need to put a QR code or something next time, yeah? Easier. I notice in the mother church, they have a sticker on the QR code on the back of the chair. So you can scan immediately. Our closing hymn is a hymn that we only sing once a year. It's called Another Year is Dawning. Let's sing this together. Another year is dawning, dear Father, let it be. In working or in waiting, another year with thee. Another year of leaning upon thy loving breath. Another year of trusting, of quiet, happy rest. Another year of mercies, of faithfulness and grace. Another year of gladness in the shining of thy face. Another year of progress, another year of praise, another year of proving thy praise. Let's rise. Another year of service, of witness for thy love. Another year of training for holier work above. Another year is dawning, dear Father, let it be on earth or else in heaven, another year for thee. Let us praise God in doxology and in faith receive his blessing taken from Hebrews 13.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, may He equip you with everything good, that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Congregation, please be seated. A couple of announcements for you. We, of course, are thankful for the successful completion of the synod meeting in Jakarta, and it is quite interesting to see how God is at work in so many, many places. We have people from Australia, from Japan, and of course, within the Indonesian community, so many, many churches. And the fervency of the people are very inspiring, and they do a lot of outreach work. Our church really do that, right? So in light of the Kalimantan trip that we just had, you know, we want to also think about our region nearby our place. So we're looking at Bintang Batam kind of a thing, and we want to work with the mother church, because you need translator, and they can translate from Bahasa Indonesia, English to Bahasa Indonesia. So it's a good collaboration. So do look forward to that as we move. And the other thing is that the one thing good about the beginning of year and all that is a time to consolidate and rethink some of the plans, right? So we are really looking at consolidating our ministry, especially Sunday school ministry. Space is always a constraint. So one of the things we are trying to see is within this building, whether we can somehow rent another place or, you know, go and co-share something so that we can have more space for Sunday school for our kids as they grow. And to do that, we do need to have more people join us in Sunday school ministry. So please prayerfully consider all these things. The thing about being in a smaller church like this means inconveniences in some ways, but it also means that there are a lot of opportunity to do things. And the way we have managed to move forward so far in this church is that we want people to come together naturally to serve God. And so you notice that in our congregation, we don't have titles for deacons and all that yet. Still not yet. We so far have been serving with people who have been very joyous in doing the work and coming in together naturally. The Christmas Eve will be one example. So the various brothers and sisters, they just go out there and they get things done, you know. So sometimes there's a little bit of confusion as to who is in charge or whatever, you kind of thing, right? But I tend not to want to run this, oh, I'm the elder, so therefore I tell you what to do, that kind of thing. I really love the idea that we come in naturally to work. Of course, that will mean that sometimes you quarrel with one another, but that's part of life. We just want to love each other and come together. May we continue to do that. And to do that, you must participate. One of the key topics that's being discussed in the synod meeting is other churches' experience. And one of the ideas is that, hey, how come in a Reformed church, always sometimes you don't know each other? People complain that, hey, I come to your church, you don't know my name, all that. Well, you have to go introduce yourself to other people, right? To be a bit more friendly, to know each other. So let us do just that. And don't keep relying on certain people or just a pastor or somebody to know everyone. You yourself should participate. And we want this community of faith to be one in which is dynamic. Not like a temple, you come and bye-bye and then you go back, you know. Don't do that. So think about all these things and pray about it carefully and watch this space, you know, as we move forward. You will find that the more you avail yourself to the Lord's work and overcome some of the challenges, the more you will realize that every word in the Bible is true. So may the Lord bless you on this special New Year Sunday, and the days ahead, may we continue to be more and more Christ-like. You may be dismissed with silent meditation. The Lord be with all of you.